Welcome to one and all who are present here for a very interesting session. What we are going to have today is on managing diabetes in eyes with different clinical settings. And diabetes per se, we know it's a burden on us, and it requires a multidisciplinary approach, not only for an ophthalmologist point of view, but from the physician side as well. And we are quite grateful to Alarcon to putting up this wonderful symposium. May I also call upon on stage Dr. Ashish Sharma, who has revolutionized the way we are doing retinal imaging nowadays and cut down on the costs significantly. His cameras are not strange to anyone. They are available by name of MI123. The series keep going on. And the way these devices are given ease of use to each and every individual practitioner, I think it's a boon and for us, and it's evolving. Like, he is constantly updating all these things over a period of time, and really I will say we should give him a kind of a big oration for this, for continuously evolving and making imaging, especially retinal imaging, quite simpler for all of us. So welcome, Ashish. And also our proud privilege to have Dr. Suresh Damodaran with us today. He is a endocrinologist and has vast experience in treating patients with diabetes mellitus. He is with Ramakrishnan Hospital at Coimbatore, and also worked extensively in UK for more than 17 years, associated with Plymouth Hospital as well. And I invite Dr. Suresh on the stage, please, with us. We also like to start first talk from the physician's perspective, as what is the physician's view of diabetic complication, and how do an ophthalmologist, what is the role of an ophthalmologist to handle and also try to refer these patients time and time again, so that the patient gets maximum benefit of not only eye treatment, retinal treatment, but also the general holistic treatment as well. So with this brief introduction, we'll invite Dr. Suresh to share his views and give us a brief introduction and present his talk on physician's view of diabetic complications. Dr. Suresh, please.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thanks very much for inviting me for this talk. And as expected, I think post-prandially, normally the crowd is normally thin, and it's extremely thin. And now, it is very interesting session. As the chairperson was saying, it is important that you see the other side of the table, what we try to do and in terms of diabetes management. I think you do get opinion for, okay, getting a cataract surgery or retinal surgery, something done, get the sugar under control. But I think the challenge is not only getting the sugar under control, it is just getting the patient adhere to the treatment, and also a lot of other challenges of controlling blood pressure and other things. I'll just go in a brief way. It is about 8 minutes talk, so I'll try to stick it to the time. So what are the complications of diabetes? So diabetes is not a mild disease. You can see it leads to microvascular and macrovascular complications, both stroke and heart disease, and in terms of diabetic nephropathy, neuropathy, and also eye disease as well. So the micro and macrovascular, the eye, kidneys, and neuropathy. Have you got any pointer? No? Right, so eye, kidney, neuropathy, and extremities and heart. So micro and macrovascular, if you can just imagine the volume, it is a vascular disease. And in terms of data, UKPDS, for example, is the almost like a gift study we had. When you try to diagnose somebody with diabetes, this is the amount of disease they already got. 21% with retinopathy, neuropathy, and erectile dysfunction and neuropathy already got, the patient had it. Now, you know about diabetes thing, as in the pathology wise, you know about insulin secretion deficiency, insulin resistance. These are the things that normally people know, but I think it has changed in currently. I'll come to the next slide, which will explain in a big way. So along with that, that hepatic glucose output, and also this is the main thing. When DiFranco presented in 2009 in ADA, there was about 15,000 people, and almost he had a standing ovation for 3 minutes. So this is the work he's done throughout his life. If you look at it, this diabetes mechanism has changed in a big way with impaired insulin secretion, incretin defect, lipolysis, and also neurotransmitter dysfunction. So it is not a simple disease, it's a complex disease as in terms of mechanism itself. You leave alone the environmental factors and the genetic factors and all polygenic etiology, but apart from that, the mechanism itself, it is so complex. So just for the intro, you see the prevalence is very high, and it's most common cause of blindness, and glaucomas, cataracts, and other disorders are the ones which you know better. And the preventive is the way forward. It is very essential to screen the people with diabetes and prompt referral to ophthalmologist. I'll come to that, what are the guidelines say, how, when to refer, and what we practically can do in our centers. So subsequent and frequent examination is very, very essential as a general practitioner or a physician or an endocrinologist or a diabetes treating person, that we have to do, come to the, at least think that we should refer and get people screened annually. So these are the factors that normally affects the diabetes retinopathy management. The one is hyperglycemia, hypertension, lipids, anemia, obstructive sleep apnea, smoking, and then obesity as well. There are quite a lot of systemic factors that is involved. So I would just go for a glycemia first, because that is the one that is the in front of your eyes, and that is what we try to do. As I said, the mechanism has changed in a big way. So what is new in diabetes? Because our kids and the population is going bigger and bigger. So the old days of thinking, okay, you got insulin secretion defect from pancreas and that's it, you don't have anything else, is gone. I think there are a lot of mechanisms. You just imagine, I got a 9-year-old type 2 diabetic going to school and having food from KFC 3 times a week. You know, so the kids are all getting plumpier and plumpier. The fat cells is a hormone secreting cells, and it talks to the brain and gut in a big way. There is a gut to brain signals, and the fat cells, pancreas, gut, and brain talks, and then hormone production, for example, leptin, adiponectin. You have to know a bit of it, because the treatment also varies. As I said, the kids are getting very, very big, and insulin resistance, you can see in the neck, the insulin resistance is getting worse and worse, and we are dealing with the new generation of diabetics, if you say. If you know what I'm saying, I think a new generation of diabetic, like a thin individual of our ancestors who worked a lot in the sun and not working and getting diabetes is different. With these kids, we are going into a really multiple thing. Now the treatments also varies, and this is a Gila monster from Pacific, and there is a molecule that is taken out from there, and that molecule is being used. It's called a gut to brain signal, is being treated. If you know the mechanism I showed, one of the mechanisms is the diminished incretin effect. Incretin is nothing but a gut hormone. So we give that as a treatment and get the weight reduced along with the diabetes control. Why I'm covering this one is I think it is very important for you to know that all the injections are not insulin. So don't think when patients comes with your ophthalmology department with injection, it is not insulin altogether. It used to be Byetta and Victoza, but now we got a new weekly ones, GLP-1s, and gliptins is in the market. You should know about it. That is sitagliptin, saxagliptin, vildagliptin, linagliptin, tenagliptin, alogliptin, omariagliptin. There is quite a lot of gliptins there, and SGLT2, which is also very important for you to know, because it can cause almost a diuretic effect, and is called a serum glucose 2 transporter system inhibitor. So that means that it will send the sugar through the kidney out, therefore the blood sugar is controlled, and modern insulin analogs, insulin pump delivery system. So the glycemic control is very, very important, intensive glycemic control. We got a lot of weapons than what used to be because of the mechanism has changed. So you see with the data, as I show that conventional intensive, it shows clearly the progression of retinopathy is diminished. And with the data, as I mentioned about UKPDS, but the DCCT is the gold standard one in type 1 diabetics. Both studies showed when the reduction of A1C is there, there is a significant reduction of progression of diabetic retinopathy. And people think, okay, I've controlled the blood sugar now, there should be a good improvement in retinopathy. It may not be all possible all the time, actually. So good glycemic control doesn't guarantee retinopathy control. However, I think the multifactorial one, as I mentioned about diabetes and glycemia, we discussed now. And then the next aspect is about the blood pressure control. It has to be intensive. Even to 1 month ago, there is new guidelines has come up with 140, 90 has been the target. It's been reduced to 130, 80 with people with diabetes. And now the data for lipid also is there with phenofibrate field study. That means that controlling the cholesterol, but it hasn't got much of evidence to show it reduces the progression of retinopathy. So there are numerous drugs have been tried for microvascular prevention, but it doesn't work. So I think the primary thing is to control the blood sugar, blood pressure, and cholesterol. But I'll come back to the screening aspect with the guidelines, as I mentioned, ADA guidelines for the type 1s within 5 years of diagnosis, and then annually if you got problem, 2 years once if you don't have retinopathy. And same thing applies to type 2. On the day of diagnosis, I try to send people for retinopathy screening. But if you don't have a problem, again, 2 yearly once. But pregnant women, England, we had a guidelines with each trust has got a different guidelines. But in that 9 months, I think it's more sensible to do a monthly screening. If we can, because the glycemic control in pregnancy, third trimester, the retinopathy can go worse. So it shows that strict glycemic control and blood pressure control, as I mentioned, but not lipid control in a big way, showed prevention or progression of retinopathy. So what I would do, or when to refer patients for screening, as I mentioned in the table box before, the type 1 and type 2, if they don't have problem, 2 yearly once. But however, I think just to maintain the compliance in our country, I am doing every year referral, and I stick to the birthday of a patient. I say to them, just go on your birthday just for an eye checkup. That just keep them in brain. You can also follow that. Barriers to earlier screening in our country, especially fear of discovering something bad. I just went through the stall initially, and I saw that there is a screening system, but a lot of people will be worried to go for a screening. So that's my summary. Just optimize the glycemic control, manage all the other risk factors, and physicians should get educated, and teamwork is needed. So in my view, I think screening is very essential. Glycemic control, I've showed you the new mechanism and the current treatment available, other risk factor control, appropriate referral, teamwork, and patient cooperation. So the diet is very important. Opening a stall at 5 o'clock and people just sitting at 3 o'clock, and then the exercise wise, I think this is December 31st and January 2nd, the hall is empty, the gym is empty, and this lady was asked to do a gym. She was told, asked to go for a gym and then use a treadmill. She's doing both with the chair there. So, and I would say teamwork is very, very essential, and that is the teamwork needed. I mean, it is a multidisciplinary teamwork, and patient attitude is important. This is the last slide. So if you attack our single soldier, we declare war against your country. If you attack us, we will take your country out of the map. And if you attack us, we pay stop cricket, playing cricket with you. This is the attitude of the patient. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Suresh. Before we move on to the next talk, I think because you are the most important speaker as far as an ophthalmologist goes for today's session for us, couple of questions and comments from you I'd like to highlight and get your opinion as well. We normally get patients who have vision loss as well as fair amount of uncontrolled diabetes systemic status. What is your cutoff when you say, okay, go ahead, or is there any cutoff you feel is not necessary, simultaneous treatment can be done? This treatment will be in form of either laser or some injections into the eye, what we call as intravitreal injections.
See, that is the challenge in our country. I don't know, people traveling far from, I don't know, the, you know, the geography here, people come from Ooty or Erode or all the rural areas, and if they come for a treatment here, they come with a blood sugar of 300 in front of you, and you say, okay, go and get it controlled and come back. Now the challenge is, if they go back, I can't monitor home glucose monitoring or anything like that in a village where they go in. So what I try to do is, not for everybody, but just try to get them admitted for one day or 48 hours, and then I say that, okay, just your sugar is under control now. I can see with the home glucose monitoring with almost like 6 times a day. Then if you get a 2 days of reading in 48 hours, the glycemia is stable and A1C is very reasonable of 8 or 9. He had hyperglycemia because of various reasons that he went into recently. Then that is the ideal candidate to go into surgery or the procedure, as you mentioned. But people have got poor compliance and everything. It is going to be real challenging. And if you can't admit them, then you have to get it done. And somewhere blood sugar around 100 to 180, I'm comfortable with. But given that they are high risk to get infections, you have to be very strict sometimes, saying from your area, saying no, and I also say no. Because it is like India, people just go in the back route and say, okay, can you get me signed off? I mean, it's not like a school seat or anything. It is just eyes that can get infected. So I am very strict about getting the control between 100, 180 maximum.
So usually, you know, whenever, you know, we talk to the physicians and whenever we have these kind of discussion, as you just rightly pointed out, that I am comfortable with the patients having HbA1c 8 and 9, which is a, you know, kind of practice that we do. It's a myth for us. We always say, you know, if we see 8 and 9, we say, you should be 7. But we know, when we interact with the physicians in a really close contact, they say, don't stress on the 7. You are going to damage his heart. So that's what, you know, so the thing is, repeatedly stressing, sometimes, you know, stressing upon the 7 and below 7. I just want to do a quick comment on that.
Actually, that is a very good point. I think you are trying to point out an ACCORD style. ACCORD trial is the one which, but that showed the intensive glycemia doesn't do any benefit. It can do some harm. That is intensive. So below 6.5 on 6, there is a potential of hypoglycemia, and hypoglycemia can trigger into a lot of other autonomic and multiple triggers, so that can lead to complications. But they didn't still find out the mechanism of ACCORD trial. But coming below 7 and everything, that is a bit strange, because that is what we are aiming for. And we know from a lot of data, even UKPDS, VADT, DCCT, and even ACCORD, everything showed that bringing the blood sugar control will reap benefits in terms of micro and macrovascular complications in a big way. So below 7 is yes, below 6.5 is sometimes too strict, and it entirely depends on the patients. And also with the new group of drugs which doesn't cause hypoglycemia in a big way, I think we should go ahead and get a strict control and then give it to you, rather than just having okay-ish blood sugar.
Another comment we need is, you have mentioned that onset less than 5 years, or, you know, approximate onset of 5 years or so, then you normally start a referral. But normally what happens is, in especially in Indian scenario, we are really not sure about the diabetes the patient has. It's just as one's random check somewhere in some camp or some, you know. So what is your take home message on that, like how you ideally select a patient for a immediate referral there as compared to a slightly deferred referral?
That is a very good question as well. But I just mentioned about 5 years for only type 1s. For example, a kid who's been diagnosed 4 year or 5 year old, then I think you can wait within that 5 years, you can get a referral done for an ophthalmologist. For type 2, on the day in a camp or whatever we are finding, already they got a chance of 20 to 25% of microvascular disease. So you need to go ahead and just do a referral. That is my way of doing, immediate referral.
Any other questions, Ashish? Okay, with this we move on to the next talk on OCT as well as intravital pharmacotherapy. Good afternoon, everyone. Before I start my talk, I see Dr. Sarvanan sir sitting in the audience. Your comment on first talk, sir. You want to add on something or sure? Because that is more important. This OCT and all is for us. But a physician role in managing diabetic retinopathy as well as general referral, that is more critical for us. You want to add anything? Okay. Later. Okay. Thanks. So we move on to OCT, how we can make it simpler, and also what are the intravitreal injections available to us and how to choose. No financial interest in my talk. Scenarios like this in regular OPDs are becoming quite commoner for us, where we see and we even doubt whether you want to treat right eye of this patient. But the OCT per se has changed the way we look at all this patient. We all know what OCT stands for and how it works for us and what are the principles of OCTs and what are the evolution over a period of time. But what you also need to keep in mind is diabetic macular edema, which is a sight-threatening disease for a particular patient, has various subtypes, and we are even evolving and learning on these subtypes of which will behave which way and what are the associations as well for that particular patient. So when we look at all this complex disease, does angiogram still has a role? Comes the first question. I will say still angiogram has a role in guiding clinically significant macular edema. Toilet, sometimes unexplained visual loss. Sometimes you also do as a baseline and unexpected, like non-clinically you've seen neovascularization. So this patient has a CME which is diffuse in nature and needs an angiogram basically to start treatment on. Again, diffuse DME not so seen severely clinically, but when you do an angiogram, you also see good amount of cystoid macular edema, though it can be also picked up on OCT. But these kind of things where you are not certain that how much of exudation is there and how much of leakage is there, better to get an angiogram also done as well. And special scenarios, though OCTA has changed the way we look at ischemic retina, especially in diabetic macular edema and diabetic retinopathy, but still angiogram has a role. So it is not that we have thrown out this machine, we still have a couple of challenging scenarios like asteroid. But the way OCT has changed in understanding this disease, as you have a focal edema which is easily treatable with intravitreal, this is immediately post-treatment. And also the diffuse DME per se has been reclassified and classified on and on again, because like spongiform, early spongiform with a massive spongiform thickening, presence or absence of neurosensory detachment and so on. So diffuse DME with large cyst like this will require repeated session of treatment. There is also disruption of inner and outer retinal layers here, more of a schisis as we can see here. I'm sorry, the pointer is not working, so we have to work with the mouse. And then you have a presence or absence of a subfoveal detachment, which indicates sometimes chronic kidney disease. So if this patient may require a period treatment over a long period of time. This was the same patient with post-injection, the OCT is flat. But we often get rebound. So here comes the role of an endocrinologist or a good diabetologist to work on with us as to make sure that this patient's systemic parameters, including diabetes, hypertension, lipid to some extent, are well controlled. And especially kidney functions test as well. This is a patient who has early spongiform thickening here, as well as some exudation in the outer retina here. But this treatment sometimes, this patient sometimes, the rebound treatment after anti-VEGF or maybe steroid in certain cases, the rebounds are somewhere worse where the systemic status is not under control. So this patient, you can see here, start a minimum intravitreal pharmacotherapy, but the systemic status was not under good control, so the rebound was quite bad. So these are the situations where we are dealing with, as you treat only on the OCT based or you treat patient as a whole is a $1 million question. I think you should go with the second one thought, that you treat patient as a whole, don't treat it only the scan, as most of all not, we have seen patients carrying just an OCT printout, so this thickness is less, this thickness is more, but still I'm not getting any visual benefit. So there's another example of spongiform thickness with an intraretinal cyst formation here, as well as tractional, which can be easily minimized if the traction is early, like in this picture, with a subfoveal exudates, denotes poorer response for any type of treatment. Fine amount of vitromacular traction can easily be missed with a clinical examination, so the OCT gives us quite an understanding of this problem. And this kind of multiplanar traction, I'm sorry, the scan has been cut, but you have a multiplanar traction here, starting from the vitreous to the epiretinal membrane on the surface to intraretinal cyst, and also you can see here there is a neurosensory detachment of the retina. This is a clear-cut case of a vitrectomy. No way this patient is going to benefit with your pharmacotherapy. Sometimes if the media is hazy, still you can pick up quite a fair amount of foveal tracts status, as this patient has a TRD involving fovea and will require a surgical intervention. This was a patient post-vitrectomy developed a secondary ARM and early macular edema. As well as in challenging scenarios like we have asteroid, we can pick up the traction with quite great extent. So how do we do analysis of a particular OCT scan? We normally believe in quantitative as well as qualitative analysis. What do I mean by that? We look at the start from the vitromacular interface, look at the thickness of the retina, the changes in the inner retinal layer, outer retinal layer, and also at the photoreceptor level. We just don't look at the thickness in terms of numbers. We look at the entire morphology of the OCT scan. So like this, you study the entire morphology of the OCT scan, see what's happening clinically as well to the retina, and then only do your decision making. Don't just interpret one scan of this printout. Also, the way we are having the choices available to us from right from macular line to macular cross, multimacular scans, EDI, enhanced imaging, SDI, everything is changing over a period of time. So we are not just looking at one particular scan. We need to sit with the OCT machine, go through the entire scan of the retina, and then take the decisions. The indications are quite numerous. I cannot go into details. But what I want to tell is like sometimes the morphological changes can also play quite a significant role. This is the OCT classification of different layers as how to interpret what are the reflectivity of different structures. Color coding is always a pseudo color coding, so we don't give too much of importance to that. However, sometimes there is a pathological reflectivity, like in this picture here, there is a ERM, there is a cotton wool spot here which mimics a hemorrhage. So you need a clinical correlation as well. And the hemorrhage, if at all it is there, is most commonly not what we used to think is always subhyaloid hemorrhage, is mostly a sub-ILM hemorrhage, where the treatment changes considerably here. So all these things has to be looked into carefully with OCT. This is a common presentation, as we see OCT is most commonly like this, where you have intraretinal edema, hemorrhages, and the heart exudate sitting right there, and we don't know how to go about the treatment. So the pharmacotherapy does play a role, but which agent to choose when is a thing which we have to use judiciously. This kind of large cysts, they do respond to pharmacotherapy quite well. However, importance of the systemic control is also equally important. The things which were changing over a period of time from the identifying the retinal layers, we are also trying to identify the markers, the biomarkers which can be easily seen on the OCT, what can predict a good amount of visual acuity change with treatment over a period of time. So these are the common findings which we have already discussed. This kind of finer planar tractions has also been looked into it, and we should not be missed in any patient when you are doing a careful OCT scan. ERMs, something like a broad-based ERMs, can easily be picked and studied, and we can even delineate the planar traction from which where you are going to attempt a traction release for this particular patient. And also fibrovascular proliferation over a period of time, we have realized that OCT gives us enough information and we don't need angiograms for this patient. Also, if the patient has active NVE, that also can be easily picked up. NVD as well, this example shows the patient has a florid NVD here, and which can be easily picked up over with OCT scan. So this kind of smaller changes in the neurosensory retina here, that is a neurosensory elevation, also indicates some kind of poor prognosis, but these patients do respond to treatment. So what are the treatment algorithms? We have seen that in DME per se, when you look at the pathophysiology, we have a role of inflammation, neovascularization, and vascular leakage. So all three are playing a part as compared to uveitis, vein occlusions, and AMD. So here, the benefit of treatment from steroids, from anti-VEGF, and the combination does play a role. So when we understand these pathologies, the things have changed over a period of time as classification, which I've already told. Investigative modalities, mainly we are relying only on OCT, and what are the treatment options. So this was ETDRS, which we normally don't follow now. We mostly follow either a clinical presence or absence of diabetic macular edema, which is center involving or non-center involving, and also OCT based, which can be even morphological in nature. So these are the 5 to 6 subtypes: focal, cystoid, diffuse edema, neurosensory detached feature, not a OCT based feature. So we see here presence or absence of edema right involving the foveal center, or if it is not involving the foveal center. If it is not involving the foveal center, the treatment is still laser. If it is involving the foveal center, then you have a plethora of treatment options available. What has changed, and what even I think Dr. Ashish is going to share with us, is imaging to the next level. What is the role of wild field, and also what is the role of non-responders on imaging. So the guiding principles is, first you classify the DME as in central involving, non-central involving. Look for the good glycemic control of these patients, including blood pressure, serum lipids, anemia if at all present. And as of now, anti-VEGFs we know are the first line of choice of treatment, but there are select groups where we need to go on alternative treatment. When to switch over from anti-VEGF, either to laser or steroid, either in non-responders, and this is this case, this is ascitic edema, may respond better to steroid than as anti-VEGF alone. For non-center DME, definitely laser still has a role. A normal green laser will suffice for this. OCT and vision are the key tests for determining your treatment outcome. However, we don't give too much of importance to vision as of now. Even the 6-6 patients warrant treatment if there is a significance of treatment on your clinical examination. And vitromacular traction changes your perspective of thinking about surgical intervention for these patients over a period of time. So how do we apply these principles? We have a patient who has bilaterally visually significant diabetic macular edema with a fairly good vision, but we do an angiogram, we see multiple leaks. This patient also has a leak here, which is a CSR leak in nature. So we are not only looking at the diabetic macular edema. This kind of subtle findings can be missed on easily on clinical examination, as you can go back and see the picture here again, which was missed by me on clinical examination. But when I did the baseline angiogram, I picked up the CSR, and this patient also had a fair amount of diabetic macular edema after getting intensive control of diabetes. This is the post treatment in form of anti-VEGF with laser, and you can see over a period of time when we persisted with treatment, a clean looking retina, which has resolved over a period of time, giving the edema has resolved over a period of time, giving good visual acuity for this patient. Another scenario, which is one of the most commonest scenario nowadays, it's actually rare to see any kind of a phakic lens in any patient. Normally we see all patients who are pseudophakic, but you have a cataract, you don't give too importance only to the cataract, you will do a careful retinal examination. And this patient received focal laser elsewhere, which has not run up to the mark, and there was also a fair amount of traction which was missed on clinical examination elsewhere. When we did an angiogram for this patient, I see a lot of peripoveal leaks here, but also the traction which was there at the surface of retina warrants some surgical intervention at some point of time. So you explain this to the patient clearly, and also keep the same thing in back of your mind. Now the question here arises, whether you go ahead only with monotherapy or a combination therapy, and when do you time your cataract surgery, and what are the retreatment schedules. Another case where you have ischemic macula, patient having renal failure with uncontrolled diabetes and hypertension. This is also one of the common scenarios. This patient was even asthmatic, and the angiogram was contraindicated, though not required in this case. Again, not a well lasered eye, but you see clinically the visual acuity was quite poor in the left eye, stating ischemia, and also the macular edema was quite significant, which warranted treatment. So this patient was a clear candidate that the intravitreal steroid will be a better choice of treatment rather than anti-VEGF. Another case where I started my discussion with, this lady has uncontrolled diabetes over a period of time. Right eye was debatable whether you want to treat or not to treat. However, when explaining the prognosis, the patient was quite motivated for treatment. I started the treatment right in 2012 April. Multiple sessions of anti-VEGF were given along with steroid and the laser. She also developed choroidal neovascular membrane in due course of time in spite of treatment in the right eye, which is also known. But when we persisted with treatment, this patient got benefit over a period of time by means combination of steroid, laser and anti-VEGF, And what you see here with persistence of treatment, though the right eye didn't benefit much visually, but there was a structural improvement, but the left eye almost started becoming near normal, and this also exudation resolved over a period of time after treatment. So the persistence is again key here, both from the physicians, ophthalmologists, as well as the patient. That also has to be clearly explained to the patient. Do we have a role of steroids in diabetic macular edema in today's scenario, where steroids are the first line of choice of treatment, though it is not approved? We do have a couple of scenarios where, in clinical situation, where the anti-VEGF has to be avoided, where effect seems to be similar with anti-VEGF, so that we can prolong the duration of treatment as 1 month as compared to 3 to 4 months. Well, there seems to be some benefit of steroids over anti-VEGF. Some examples I'll show you. And are there anti-VEGF non-responders in DME as well, though not known? So couple of scenarios where we have pregnancy, history of recent stroke, history of MI, recent vitrectomy, we feel steroids, especially the dexamethasone implant, works better here. And treatment, what about treatment name-wise? So there seems to be some benefit, as been shown by Rise and Ride as well as Bivordex study in subgroup analysis, that the steroids in select group of patients work better for diabetic macular edema as anti-VEGF. And when you don't have a good amount of vitreous sump for the drug to be absorbed, so that if there is a scenario, then steroid has a better penetration and better role. This kind of intractable hardness, if respond better to steroid. Do we have tachyphylaxis? Not so common reported in diabetic macular edema, but there are also a lot of emerging trends, especially when we understand the epidemiology and the prevalence of diabetic retinopathy, and also these are going to tell us that future treatment directions as well. So we are also learning and evolving over a period of time. And this was the consensus based evidence based diabetic macular edema management given by our Indian group, published in AIOC in 2016, also has given us insights on how multidisciplinary approach is better. Then there was a survey by the AISRS where they have clearly shown whether how many injections are required, and the survey clearly says that the number of injections in non-responder or poorly responder over a period of time for diabetic macular edema are coming down. So we are looking for an alternative treatment in these patients, and not only with monotherapy alone. And what we have the current understanding, if you just tell me to summarize it, we should have a non-center involving macular edema, then focal laser. If there is a central involvement, phakic patient prefer anti-VEGF. Center involving diffuse edema, pseudophakic anti-VEGF or steroid can be chosen over a period of based on the physician and the patient's discretion. Center involving neurosensory detachment, phakic, pseudophakic, anti-VEGF or steroid again can be debatable. You can choose either. Diabetic macular edema, PDR, anti-VEGF has a role. However, this PDR should be non-tractional in nature to start on with. Vitrectomized eyes, steroids scores better, as well as in pregnant ladies. Recent history of stroke or a CVI, steroids have a role to play here. And recalcitrant cases, we always look for vitrectomy as an option, plus minus injection of intravitreal pharmacotherapeutic agents. So equally important is your systemic status, lens status and perfusion status of the retina, classification, and also the financial status of the patient in Indian scenarios. Visual acuity, no more a criteria. FFA still has a role in select cases. However, I do still do a baseline FFA in most of my patients, unless and until it is contraindicated. OCT at repeated intervals is the way to look forward, and we are at the combination treatment modality zone. This kind of patients which have central involvement or non-central involvement macular edema can easily be managed and treated with a fair amount of improvement in visual acuity. So we are not only talking about injections, not about switching always, not about algorithms. We are also talking about a personalized approach for each and every patient. We have so many trials available, but when you come to real-time situation for that particular patient, we also need to see that blindness is due to diabetes is preventable. And diabetes is a disease which can only be controlled but cannot be cured. So that also has to be put across. And we are privileged to have good physicians like you, sir, to share the approach with us. where you have the prime role, we are at the secondary role, and so that ultimate care to the patient can be given. Lot of ophthalmologically new agents are going to come, which will change the way we are treating as of now in 5 to 7 years time. So the take home message is laser still has a role. Think of combination therapy in most often of the scenarios, and also systemic parameters have to be given due importance. When we think about pharmacotherapy, we have anti-VEGF and steroid to choose. However, economics also play a role. OCT has to be studied for each and every individual patient with a tailor-made approach, and give due importance to your clinical examination and understanding your patient needs, which will help you in crucial, help you crucially in making good decision making for that particular patient. Thank you very much for a patient hearing.
Dr. Suresh, actually, Dr. Khatri has shown some of the beautiful images where the hard exudate, they are sitting on the macula. So basically the question, because you are here, so what we do sometimes, and which has come up from the evidence, is also patients who have the borderline high cholesterols, means they are not out of the limit. What is our so-called limit? We would like to start them on the statins or fenofibrate or something. But when this goes to the diabetologist, he just denies it. But as per the data, if you see, you do get benefit out of these medicines in clearing up a little bit faster of those exudates. So what is your take on that,
Your point is well made, but even, it's a pragmatic way of looking at it. Even if you don't get benefit, or if you think there is not that good evidence for having anti-lipid therapy for not progression of diabetic, even if you think that way, but it will be beneficial for that individual from kidney point of view and heart point of view to have a statin or a fibrate. Yes, I take the point, the field study is not a positive study. It is almost a negative study, but it showed a benefit in retinopathy aspect. So may not be the fibrate is the best choice for me. I would just go for, if the triglycerides is up and LDL is up, and you got somebody who's got a microvascular disease established with urine ACR, albumin creatinine ratio is going up, that will also indicate that ice is also going off. So in that case, I would put on statin like you. That will help us to reduce the progression, even though we don't have a very good evidence for lipids. But I'm not sure who's stopping your statins. No, I think you'll find the doctors.
Means even if that is almost reasonably under control, defined limit is not crossing.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think what he's trying to say is the cholesterol, even if it's in the normal limit, whether you should treat or not. Answer is definitely yes. If you are diabetic, there is a trial called CARDS trial, which showed a clear benefit. Even if your cholesterol is normal, if you just give a statin, it will reduce the macrovascular, which is the stroke risk, by almost 20 to 30%, which is quite significant. So I would definitely go for a statin in kind of diabetic patients.
Okay, thank you very much for the good discussion. We move on to Dr. Ashish for his talk, and then we invite Dr. Lalit Verma sir also to join us on the dais, please.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. So Dr. Lalit is here now, and we have got the brilliant insight from the physician's perspective, and we got the brilliant insight from Dr. Manoj Khatri. I think they have taken away half of my presentation, I guess. So basically my talk is when to refer to a retina specialist. These are my disclosures. So now, why are we talking about that, when to refer to a retina specialist? There is an obvious reason for it. We are sitting on a population which is 65 million in this country at present, and we have approximately 50,000 odd, or probably means more than that, the primary care physicians, where the patient comes first in the contact. And we have approximately 18,000 to 20,000 eye specialists, which are the primary eye care providers. And on top of the pyramid, we have approximately 1,000 retina specialists. So now back to the topic that when to refer to a retina specialist. So do you think, you know, that this tiny population can take care of this? No. So ideally, you know, the first thing that we should concentrate on this level. There has been a lot of models being tried across the globe by, you know, taking the telemedicine other way, but things are not going the way that they should go. Recently, we are quite excited about, you know, that deep learning. I would just share a few slides at the end of my talk. But what we are going to talk about today is the kind of wise referral that an eye specialist at least should make. Because in this country, at least we should prevent the blindness at that level. So now again, the question comes that whom are we talking about? Are we talking about the ophthalmologist who is equipped? Or are we talking an ophthalmologist who is not equipped? Because the referral would differ. If an ophthalmologist who is equipped with a fundus camera, FFAs, OCT, and he has a little bit of laser, then the referral, kind of referral patients would differ. And the skills also makes difference in the kind of, you know, the referral we should have. Now, unfortunate statistic. This statistics comes from the data which was published by the Indian Institute of Public Health in Hyderabad and the London School of Tropical Hygiene in the UK. What it says is 70% of government clinics in this country and 43% of private clinics in this country, they lack retina imaging instruments. So now we are back to the square one. So we should think, you know, 70% of the government clinics, they lack retina imaging instrument. That means, you know, we should have a real early referral. So only non-referral, I'm just giving an example. This is a very subtle case where patient has no complaint. We hardly see few microsomes. Those, you know, patients can come into a category called the non-referral. But this is the example of case one. If you see just the fundus photograph, there are few microaneurysms that you see right in the center. Patient has slight, you know, metamorphopsia. So these kind of patients, you do refer. If you are not equipped well with the angiogram or OCT or anything, because once you do an angiogram, you will be surprised at what kind of the diffuse edema patient is going on. And if you just think that, you know, there are few microaneurysms, that's what I am seeing, you might, you know, the patient might have ended up in losing vision gradually. This is another case, you know, this is a, even, you know, patient doesn't complain anything because macula is pretty good. But there are very tiny subtle changes on the outside which sometimes, you know, if you do not have the imaging, so it is better to refer because you never know what kind of, you know, results the angiogram would show. So this is a quite a naive kind of case, you know, very quiet case. Once you see the imaging, you see florid neovascularization. Another case, as you know, I think one slide Dr. Khatri also showed, these are the astroid hyalosis. Astroid hyalosis, you know, is difficult to see even on the indirect in the 90D, and if you examine, you might miss. But once you do an angiogram, you see what's happening here. It's really bad. So if you are not acute well, even these...
3 minutes left to complete last slide.
Okay. So now next stage comes to that what kind of referral you should have for the surgical retina people. If you have little bit of setup, premacular hemorrhage, because he can do a much better job. Another case, again hemorrhage, refer it to a surgical retina person. He can do a much better job. Repeated hemorrhages. Cases like these where you have ERM edema is not coming down, he can do a much better job. Cases like FVPs, he can do a much better job. So these kind of referrals should go to a retina specialist. And these kind of cases where response is not coming, VMT is there, do a referral. Now the last slide that I would like to talk about, which I mentioned in the beginning, the deep learning. This is the, you know, current hope that we have to have, you know, that billions of population. If the artificial learning, which has shown the real good science in these couple of papers recently published, and the big companies like Intel, big companies like Google is all involved in this. If we get through this, I think we can make really a lot of change in early referral. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ashish, for the wonderful presentation.
Thank you, Ashish. I think this session was designed practically for managing diabetic eyes in clinical settings. So I will just present one or two slides only. You see, this data, I think all of you come across, that patient keep receiving injection, and injection. And it's very, the reason we are trying to hurry up is because time is less. Can you give this control here? This is not moving. Okay. You see, patients are not destined just to, you know, keep paying bills and bills. In fact, people who practice medical retina, they are, you see, at least not unfamiliar with this, multiple injections going on. And patient often complains, sir, kab tak you will keep giving injection. So diabetic retinopathy, believe me, is not just inject into the eye or DME, just anti-VEGF injection. Diabetic retinopathy has a whole lot to, you know, there are inflammatory markers available. And I keep arguing that if steroids can work in a resistant case, why not start steroid early? So what is preventing you? Like Ozurdex, I have myself become a fan of Ozurdex. Reason being that we used to use Ozurdex as a non-responding case or resistant case or in a pseudophakic patient. But believe me, I have started giving in phakic eyes also. Ozurdex per se does not cause so much of cataract or glaucoma. I am not talking of fluocinolone or that insert, which has 80% cataract. But this, frankly speaking, I have a lot of photographs to show where cataract does not increase much, and the chance of giving anti-glaucoma medication, one medication, that too in around 15% of patients. Most of the patients with Ozurdex will not show a spike, and none of my patients has ever gone to incisional surgery at all. So the rationale what we use, I'll just take opinion from Mohan Rajan and others, also Kothari is here. How do you manage start your patients of DME? Do you start injecting anti-VEGFs, steroids, or only DME?
I prefer Ozurdex.
Kothari?
I prefer Ozurdex.
Next?
If the anti-VEGF is basically we need to choose only between anti-VEGF and steroid. If it is a phakic eye with a focal edema, you think of pharmacotherapy, I'll choose anti-VEGF for a couple of injections, not responding, then shift to steroid. But if it is pseudophakic, my choice will be a intravitreal steroid.
Correct. That is true. In fact, all of us, including me, we start treating these patients on injection. But you see, there has been a recent study published by Praveen Duggal from US. We give two or three injections. There could be three kinds of responding. One patient responds and continues to respond with the injection. But if patient does not respond to two injections of anti-VEGF, it makes wise sense to shift into Ozurdex. Because if you keep injecting in a patient who has less than 5 letters of improvement or less than 1 line of improvement, if you keep injecting him, I think you are doing injustice. So because this study tells us that there could be a marker in the sense that for two injections, patient has not improved. So shift to another. Whereas if patient continues to improve on anti-VEGF, you can very well continue. So my take home would be that if patient does not improve or shows less improvement, or if you want to objectivize it, less than 1 line improvement after 2 anti-VEGF injections, I will shift into Ozurdex, whether phakic or pseudophakic. This is what I have learned over the course of 3-4 years, that you should shift this non-responders or low responders.
Yeah, I will agree with you, Lalit, because we have a higher this thing of using the Ozurdex, because the complications related to Ozurdex, like the secondary glaucoma or even the cataract formation, is very, very less, as you rightly said. And the Ozurdex definitely works much better for diabetic macular edema, in my opinion. When I want to combine the cataract surgery for the diabetic macular edema treatment, I would combine a cataract surgery with the Ozurdex.
The other two reasons are that, you see, it makes from the point of view of patient also, if not 6 months, which Ozurdex claim, which is not true, Ozurdex does work for 4 months, because a lot of my patients who come from far off distance, so you give one injection and then 4 months he may not come back. You see, you can do monitoring, but you don't have to poke a needle inside for 4 months. And the third reason for my recommending is that it makes economic sense today. Because economic sense means that you calculate the cost of injections for 4 months and you calculate the cost of Ozurdex plus injection. The cost today for Ozurdex comes out cheaper. Yes, sir.
Sir, just I want to ask you, you said that this drug will work for 4 months.
Yes.
So just a couple of questions to you. One, if it's going to systemic, whether it will affect metabolic control, number one. And number two, a long-term steroid in the body, there will be an adrenal suppression. So I don't know in the evidence what you got, whether there is anything related.
I don't see, I am not aware of any study where it has been shown that injecting steroid and that too a gentle release steroid injected inside the eye affects the metabolic control or affects the adrenaline pathway, that it suppresses the system.
No,
system.
This is a sustained release steroid. It's we are
sustained
talking
release, but so it releases.
There will be definitely a systemic.
Systemic absorption leading to high blood sugar values.
Sure. But I don't think so. It happens.
I mean, I haven't seen the study, but I'm just asking you.
We have not come across.
We have not seen any patient wherein there's a hyperglycemia or the glycemic control is very poor or something like that with even multiple doses of Ozurdex injection. So we have not seen that at all.
I have not. Clinically, we don't see. Maybe it is a good idea to study them. Maybe, a joint team of surgeons as well as physicians. This is one patient I would like to show. This was a vitrectomized eye. Unfortunately, this pellet broke up into two, but nevertheless, response was fantastic, even one shot of Ozurdex. So this is the OCT which shows after one shot of Ozurdex in a vitrectomized eye. So vitrectomized eye, pseudophakic eye, patient who do not respond adequately to two injections, or resistant DME. So these 4 or 5 categories, I think it, today, why I say so, because economic sense also, you give 4 injections of, say, any anti-VEGF, and you give 1 Ozurdex, economically scales tilt towards Ozurdex. Any other comment? Dr. Sharma, you can comment upon that.
So come back to the point of Suresh. Suresh, as Dr. Lalit said, that we do not really have the data. Anti-VEGF do cross the barrier and they go. That's why those microvascular complications. We published one paper where incidentally I found that you give Ozurdex in one eye, edema was reduced in the other eye. So we just proposed, but it was just a case. So you can really not point out that whether it goes into systemic circulation and does something.
I think we'll have to close it now because the other session
we'll
is about to start.
We'll just take one question from the audience. I've got
five of them. Yeah, yeah.
The first question I will take, and which is, do we need to buy an OCT machine?
100%.
Dr. Lalit's, come on. Chairman Scientific Committee has to say.
No. The reason because today we have become actually slaves of OCT. I am telling you honestly, it's not a question of financial involvement at all. We do a lot of academic OCTs. And believe me, your whole thought process changes. 200%. OCT, one single thing why you should have, because it rules out traction. Because I will be very hesitant to inject Ozurdex or any injection inside the eye without having an OCT. Because OCT is only one machine which can tell you about vitreomacular traction. So even if you are a cataract surgeon, you are doing premium IOLs, Mohanrajan does so many premium IOLs. So if OCT control is normal, like I showed, if OCT control is normal, he will be very confident that this patient will recover. If, because there are so many hidden pathologies, epithelial membrane, some pucker, some small block, it may happen.
Sorry, sir.
We have already stopped.
Thank you so much for the patient hearing. Thank you.